Am I audible?
Yes, 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 Chandrasekhar.
So,
I'm sorry, I could not recognize you somehow. So it's long time. So I just would like to, I thought maybe somebody in the audience, there is one more Chandrasekhar, just.
No, there. I'm actually logged in two devices.
Okay. So I'd like to invite Dr. Chandrasekhar Lakshmi Narayanan. Again, he was our alumni and he got his PhD in 2016, and he was a postdoctoral fellow at Department of Computer Science, University of Alberta, and research scientist at DeepMind London for almost for a 1 year. Then he moved to IIT Palakkad, and very recently, I think just last month, he moved to IIT Madras to, you know, as a faculty. And basically his research interests include deep learning, reinforcement learning, stochastic approximation algorithm. And he's also interested in machine learning for human in loop system. Chandrasekhar, please go ahead. Yeah, thanks.
So am I audible?
Yes. Yeah, we can see your screen.
Okay. So yeah. So thanks, Professor Shanab and Professor Ambedkar for the invitation. So today I'll be talking entirely on deep learning, and this is joint work with my student Amit Vikram Singh, who was a bachelor student there, and he graduated last year. Currently is in the industry. And so the title of the talk is Dismantling the Deep Neural Network Black Box. So let's get started. The question that we really are asking is deep learning alchemy? So that's kind of a big debate. So it all started with Andrew Ng sort of commented saying that artificial intelligence is the new electricity, and to which Ali Rahimi, who is the Test of the Time Award in NeurIPS 2017, in his acceptance speech, he said that the current state of machine learning is kind of alchemy, and he was actually alluding to deep learning. And Jan Lokum kind of responded to this comment saying that alchemy, the word alchemy is insulting, and and it's sort of wrong. And if we really don't like something, it's better that one should go and fix it. And Ali Rahimi sort of clarified, saying that the sort of rigor he is asking for is simple experiments and simple theorems. And so basically, what he's asking is for pedagogical nuggets. Right. And so you had this quote by James Mickens, who said in his keynote speech at USENIX 2018 that, so we really don't know what's happening with the weights of a neural network. So the stuff is what the stuff is, brother. So you just wake up, go to work and use the weights and go home. Right. So the goal is to explain the success of deep learning by means of simple, elegant theory and experiments. Right. And so the agenda for today's talk is the following. So initially we will look at deep neural networks as representation learning machines. And we will look at the connection between infinite bit DNNs and kernel machines. And later on we will move on to our work, which is based on a novel neural path framework, where the core idea is to look at neural networks as wires that run from the input to the output and not essentially as layers, right? So there's sort of a principle of duality where the neural networks are behaving as layers as well as wires, right? And so first we will look at deep neural networks as representation learning machines as we know them, the reason why we believe they are successful, or the current reason why we believe that they are successful. Right, so let us just look at the need for feature transformation by a simple motivating example. So let us say in this simple data set of blue dots and red crosses, the goal is to actually separate the dots from the crosses, and the actual data itself is in Cartesian coordinates, and So if you actually transform it into polar coordinates, then what happens is that the data becomes linearly separable, and one can actually learn a linear classifier, right? So the point that I'm trying to make here is that extracting useful features is very important in machine learning. And DNNs are able to automatically learn high-level feature transformations and high-level representations and directly from data, right? So how are they doing it, right? So let us just look at a fully connected DNN of depth D and width W. That is, there are D layers and there are W units per layer. And in each layer, there is a linear operation, which is basically a matrix multiplication followed by a nonlinear activation function. And the typical nonlinearities are something like rectified linear units, sigmoids, or tanh, right? And so what happens is that as you train the neural network by, say, any of the standard methods, such as you use gradient descent and then you use backpropagation of the gradients to train the weights of the neural network, right? And as you start training from randomized initialization, so the idea is that the low level features are learned in the initial layers and the median level features are learned in the intermediate layers, and the higher level feature is learned in the penultimate layer, and the final layer just learns a linear model in the features given by the penultimate layer. So basically, the power comes from depth. So as you keep the output itself is a nested composition of nonlinear maps, and as you increase the depth, the nesting is also deeper, and which is why we are able to represent more and more complicated relationships between the input and the output, right? And so this is why we believe that neural networks are really powerful in coming up with complicated representations. And in order to be successful in domains such as images, what we need is an extra ingredient, which is known as convolutional operation, where so given an image, so a convolutional window sort of goes over each image, and it basically the convolutional filters help us in extracting useful features from the images, such as say edge detection, or it can sharpen the image, or it can blur the image, so on and so forth. Right. So having convolution itself is not an issue, because you can just think of it as weight sharing in a fully connected deep neural network. And another ingredient that typically is used is something known as subsampling, pooling operation, where you take a patch, right? Like, for example, you take a 2x2, basically 4 pixels, and then you replace that patch with either the average value of the patch or the maximum value of the patch, right? So these are the additional ingredients that are required to extract useful features in the case of images. And what we have is that in domains such as image classification, basically deep learning is the state of the art. This is just just the tip of the iceberg. Deep learning is actually successful in a variety of applications, right? And the point that I want to make here is that the reason for success is basically feature or representation. Right? So let us just summarize what we have. So basically we have the ingredients. The ingredients is that we have the weights, we have nonlinear activations, and we have convolutions and pooling. And the methodology is to set up the deep network, initialize the weights at random, and use automatic differentiation, such as say TensorFlow or any of the tools, right? So that give you automatic differentiation that propagate the gradients from the output to the intermediate layers, and then you just train the network, right? And why does this work? This works because DNNs are universal function approximators, which is what we know from the classical result of Hornick. And the reason why they are able to learn is that what we believe is that DNNs learn increasingly sophisticated features going from the initial to the final layers. Okay, so all this is fine, right? And but then there are some really big questions related to DNNs, especially related to the training, generalization, what is the role of the ingredients that go in, right? Like such as the weights, the depth, the widths, the activations. I mean, these are the very components or the parameters that actually go into specifying a deep neural network, right? And we really don't know what these are actually doing beyond a point, or at least in simple terms, we are not able to understand. There are some big questions, and the representations that are learned and the overall interpretability of these models. Okay, so let us go over these questions one by one. So the first question itself is basically what is known as the training question, right? So we know that the loss surface of a deep neural network is not convex, right? And the issue with non-convexity is that gradient descent can get stuck at local minima, right? And if it is a convex problem, you will get global minima. Or global minimum, and or if there are multiple global minima, all of them are connected, right? So that's the issue. But what we typically see is that you take an off-the-shelf neural network, and on standard data sets such as say MNIST, C410, C400, you train an off-the-shelf neural network, and you're sort of fine, right? Like the training error goes to zero, right? So despite its non-convexity, where the training actually could get stuck at a local minimum, it seems that the training error goes to zero, which means that this non-convexity is not a problem, right? So this is the training question. Okay, so now going to the next question, which is basically the generalization question. So the generalization question is actually related to over-parameterization. Right. So standard deep neural networks are actually so much over-parameterized that they can actually overfit even random labeling of standard data sets. Right. So you are even they can even you provide when you provide Gaussian noise, they're able to overfit. Right. So but then despite this over-parameterization, when you actually provide the proper data set, the good data set with proper labels, there seems to be no issue, right? So, I mean, what does this tell us? This kind of goes against the our standard intuition that if the model is so powerful that, so powerful that it can even memorize even very complicated labeling of data sets, despite the power, it's when you provide it with the proper data set, it's not actually overfitting, right? So, like, why does this happen, right? And typically, right, the classical the entire goal of machine learning itself is to train models, and you want them to actually perform well on test data, right? And one way to guarantee is to say that the test error will be lesser than the training error plus what is known as the generalization gap, which scales as square root of number of parameters by the number of data points. Okay, so a very standard off-the-shelf model, it's like 50x off, which means that this generalization bound itself is sort of vacuous. The standard bounds are sort of vacuous, and we sort of know that these models are very powerful, but yet, even though they can actually even overfit, they can even totally memorize even random labeling of the data sets, they really are performing well and then learning the right things when you provide them with the actual data, right? And then the very ingredients that go into building a neural network, which is basically its weights, its depth, the widths, and the activations. So we really don't have a clear understanding of what these things are doing, right? For instance, let us take this case of depth, right? So the entire point about deep learning is that as you go deeper, you would be able to get more and more sophisticated representations, right? But in reality, in practice, right? Like, so as you keep increasing depth, it sort of helps till a point, but after some point of time, it starts hurting, right? So basically, as in, you can take a 20-layer network, which performs both in test as well as train, it performs better than a 56 layer network, right? But this situation itself can be remedied by what is known as a residual network with skip connections, where you sort of you feed the input, you skip the blocks, and then you sort of jump and you feed the input, right? So this situation can be remedied in practice, but still there is something to be explained right? Because we were believing that more depth is always good, right? So then comes the representation question, right? Which is basically, so if you want to really understand what sort of inputs a particular neuron is responsive to, right? So you can set it up as an optimization problem in the space of input images, and then you can sort of optimize for that image, which will maximize the activity of a particular neuron. And when you do that, what we observe is this kind of a very random image, which is completely not intelligible at all, right? And the sort of representations, right? And the overall universal approximation theorem itself says it's whatever it says, it's for the space of all functions that are representable by DNNs, right? But in practice, what we do is that we start with a randomized initialization, and then we use a simple procedure such as stochastic gradient descent, which is a variant of gradient descent, basically, right? And then what we do is we train the models with this specific algorithmic variants starting from randomized initialization. So which means that in practice, the set of functions that are actually reached of all functions that are representable by DNN. So what's actually getting represented or what sort of representation is really being learned in practical DNNs is something that we are supposed to understand. So and we really don't have a handle of the inner workings, right? Like what's really happening in the intermediate layers, how it is processing the information as the information goes through the layers. We really don't have a handle of how it is getting processed, right? So these are the big questions. Right. So, and so we would now look at the connection between the recent works for the past 2-3 years that happened that connected infinite bit DNNs to what is known as the neural tangent kernel, which is basically which is basically connecting a neural network to kernel machines, right? So so the idea here is that take a neural network and increase its bits to infinity, right? So that you kind of start studying a limiting case of a deep neural network. Even though you say that, okay, fine, let me try to understand an idealized model and then see how much of that intuition I can take when it comes to a practical model, right? So let us look at what are kernel machines, right? First, okay. I think I have an issue here. Yeah, sorry, I got sort of logged out. I'm trying to log in again. Yeah. Am I audible?
Yeah. Yes, you are.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, so let us look at the connection between, so let us look at what are kernel machines, right? So basically kernel machines are, basically kernel methods are a similarity, you know, based on similarity scores, right? So what happens is that, so here you can have a, I mean, here is a toy example where we have two classes of, two kinds of examples, two cats and two dogs. And so the central quantity in a kernel method is the kernel matrix, which gives the scores between any of any given pair of input examples, actually. So typically what you would expect is that the score for examples coming from the same class is higher than the scores for examples coming from different class. So here this is some kind of a toy example where you know, for both if the examples that are compared are cats, then the score is high, and if the examples that are compared are dogs, the score is high, and the score between cat and the dog itself is zero, right? So you can imagine that given a data set, you have this big, I mean, you have this n cross n matrix, right? And now if you were to think of kernel regression, right? So the all that you need is a kernel matrix, and what you do is you form the kernel matrix, and the weights are nothing but the inverse of the kernel matrix times the label vector, and any new prediction is basically so you learn the weights alpha, which is basically obtained by inverting the kernel matrix and multiplying it with the labels. And what you do is that this alpha gives the sort of importance of each of the example in the data set, and given any new example, you just measure how similar it is to each of the examples in the data set, and then multiply it by the importance weight alpha that you learned, and then you predict, right? And the nice thing here is that the generalization error here, the generalization gap, is given by the quantity which depends on the quadratic norm measured with respect to the inverse of the kernel matrix. So the reason why this is great is that we can actually distinguish between good and bad labeling of the data set, right? So if you have bad labeling, then even though you would be able to learn, then you will not be able to generalize, because the generalization error basically depends on the norm of the label with respect to the inverse of the kernel matrix, right? So this is nice. So what people manage is to connect kernel machines to the infinite with DNNs. So a kernel that is closely related to a deep neural network is what is known as the neural tangent kernel, which is basically a kernel based on the gradients, right? It's a similarity score based on the gradients. So two examples are similar. If the gradient of the output of the neural network with gradient of the with respect to the weights for these two examples, if the inner product of the two gradients, right, you take the inner product of the two gradients, and if the gradients are similar, then you say that two examples are similar. Right? So it's essentially a similarity metric based on the gradients. Okay, so why does this crop up all of a sudden? So some intuition. So here, let us take a data set with just two examples, right? Say x1 and x2, and then so the error is basically the difference between the predicted value and the true value, right? And then for a small change in the output, right? And then for a small change in the output, right? A small change in the weights, the change in the output is basically nothing but the inner product of the gradients and the change in the parameter, right? Change in the weights. And in the case of say squared loss, the change in the delta theta, the change in the weights itself is directly proportional to the gradient of the loss, which again is a linear combination of the gradients themselves, right? And if you put all of these things together, you will the similarity metric based on the gradients, which is basically the neural tangent kernel, it shows up, right? So in very simple terms, for very, very infinitesimally small step size of alpha, the change in the error is nothing but minus alpha times k times e. Right? That's the key takeaway. So this is why neural tangent kernel sort of shows up naturally in gradient descent. It's just that for a small change in output is basically given by the gradient times the change in the parameter, and the parameter itself is again changing according to the gradient because we are doing gradient descent. So you get the inner product of the gradients. Right. So yeah, this is fine. Now what happens is that so what people manage to show is that especially Aurora et al. What they manage to show is that as you increase the width of the neural network to infinity, the gradient descent itself tracks an ordinary differential equation, right, which is given by E dot equals minus k times e, right, and also as you increase the width of the network to infinity, the neural tangent kernel at randomized initialization actually converges to a constant matrix given by k star. And basically, training a neural network, infinitely wide neural network, starting from randomized initialization, is equivalent to a kernel method with this matrix K star. So, since we have shown that the neural network itself, infinitely wide neural network itself, is equivalent to a kernel method, the generalization bound that applies to the kernel method applies here as well. So, which means that we really know. That okay, you can train these things, and when you train, you will also know how the generalization bound looks, and it also sort of explains the behavior with the random labeling of data, right? So if you even though you can train with random labels, you will not see good generalization because the generalization error now depends on the quadratic norm of the labels measured with respect to the inverse of the kernel matrix. So the questions that Aurora et al. Asked is that, okay, fine. So the infinite width kernel method itself is equivalent to a deterministic kernel matrix. And what happens to the finite width? What is the difference between the finite width DNN and the kernel method with this deterministic matrix? Right? And how good is the deterministic matrix itself? Right? Because this deterministic matrix can be computed. You can get an analytical expression, and one can compute it by dynamic programming technique. And then they went ahead and then implemented this kernel method, and then compared it with the DNN. So what they considered was that they considered two models: one which is the vanilla model given by V, and then the other model which is GAP, which is global average pooling. And then they compared the neural tangent kernel, which is basically the kernel of the infinite width DNN, with the performance of that and the performance of the DNN itself. And then what they found out is that the neural tangent kernel, right, the kernel corresponding to the infinite width DNN, that performs better than other state of the art kernel methods by 10%. But the finite width DNN still outperforms the infinite width neural tangent kernel by 5-6%, and they also saw that pooling and depth helps both the infinite as well as the finite width DNNs. Right. So the summary is that infinite width DNNs are equal to a kernel method with deterministic neural tangent kernel matrix, and the kernel method with the deterministic neural tangent kernel matrix beats other kernels. Right, but the open question is that we want to understand why finite width DNNs are still better than the neural tangent kernel with this deterministic matrix. And also the thing is that the neural tangent kernel itself does not explain representation learning, right? Because the kernel matrix itself is fixed, and it does not explain why depth helps. It does not explain why pooling helps, and beyond a point, you really cannot interpret the kernel because it's just kernel based on gradients, and there is no physical interpretation. Right. So with respect to the big questions, a couple of questions have been answered. The training and testing question has been answered, at least in the infinite depth regime. But there is something to be understood. What is to be understood is the difference between the finite and the infinite depth regime. And we want to understand the role of the various other components, namely the weights, depth, width, and activations. And we also have to understand the representation and interpretability question. Okay, so this takes us to the our part of our work. Which is basically based on a novel neural path framework. Which applies to DNNs with rectified linear units, right? So the rectified linear units have a special property, which is the gating property, right? So each ReLU activation itself acts as a gate, which either allows the input or it either blocks the input. Okay, so you can just think of it as a 0-1 signal, and then if the input is if the gate is on, it sort of it multiplies the pre-activation by 1, and if the input is sort of less, if the gate is sort of off, then it multiplies the pre-activation by 0, right? And so each ReLU you can interpret it as a gate. And what do we get by that interpretation? What we get is that we can conceptualize or interpret the entire neural network as made of subnetworks. As in, for each input example, there is a set of gates, rectified linear units that are on. Right, and the weights through those gates kind of produce the output for that input, right? And for different inputs, different set of gates are on, right? Even though the weights are the same for every input, for different input, different set of gates are on, which means different subnetworks are doing the work for different inputs. And potentially what can happen is that at randomized initialization, these active subnetworks, right? So the subnetworks that are active for each of these inputs, for the different inputs, are random at randomized initialization. And as you train the network, this could also be learned, right? So the goal of the work is to actually characterize the information stored in the gates and the active subnetworks. Okay. So we will now look at the theoretical characterization of the gates, right? What we did is to break down the neural network in terms of paths, right? So there are exponentially many paths that are running from the input to the output. So basically a path is something that starts, is just a path, right? Like it's just intuitive. A path starts at an input node, passes via a gate and a weight in each layer, and then it ends at the output node, right? So, I mean, here, without loss of generality, we are considering one output node. The same thing can be extended to networks with multiple output nodes, but yeah, so that's just a technical point here, right? So there are totally, if there are d in is the input dimension, then the total number of paths is d into w power d minus 1. So there are exponentially many paths, and each path contains gates as well as weights. So now what we will do is to sorry, I got dropped again. Yeah. So, my audible? Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. So basically, what we do is we can define what is known as a path activity, which is basically product of all the gates in the path. Right. So, and we can define what is known as the path feature, which is the product of the path activity and the signal at the input node. Right. And you define what we define what is known as the path value, which is the product of the weights in the path. Right? And once you do that, and then you can collect these quantities for each of the paths, and then call the define what is known as the neural path feature, which is basically the path feature of all the paths, and the neural path value, which contains the path values of all the paths. And both the neural path feature and the neural path value are quantities residing whose dimensionality is equal to the total number of paths. Right? From here onwards, we will just be referring to the neural path feature and neural path value as NPF and NPV. Right? And since it's a ReLU network, what you can do is that you can express the output as the inner product of the neural path feature and the neural path value. Right? So you actually literally dismantle the DNN into individual paths, and akin to a, you know, if you were to compare this in an analogous manner to a standard linear model, the neural path feature is like your feature and the neural path value is like your weight vector, right? And what we will end up showing is that actually the neural path feature is more important than a neural path value, as in if you have the right features, you can always learn the values, just as you learn the weights with the right features in a standard linear model, right? So yeah, so let us just go over a simple example to see how these things look, right? So here is a network with just four activations, four gates, right? There is an input node and an output node, so there are basically four paths. Right, and say suppose for some example, the neural path value itself is basically the multiplication of the weights in each path. So for the first path, you have 0.1 times 0.2 times 0.7, and for the second path, you have 0.1 times 0.3 times 0.6, and so on and so forth. Right, and the neural path activity, which is basically suppose you know for this particular example, some of the gates are on and some of the gates are off. You know that path P1 and P2 are on and path P3 and P4 are off. And then, so you know that the neural path activity basically encodes this binary information. And the neural path feature itself is just the neural path activity times the input at the signal at the input node. Right? And then the output itself is just the inner product of the neural path feature and the neural path value, right? So now you really don't have to compute this neural path feature and neural path value because it's automatically getting computed in the standard neural network calculation. All that we are saying is that we are just capturing this in our analysis, right? Because the number of paths is going exponentially with depth. You really don't have to compute these things. These are already getting computed in a standard deep neural network with rectified linear units. So what we said initially is that we can think of these neural networks with rectified linear units in terms of the subnetworks, right? So now what we can think, so for any two inputs, right, the correlation between any two inputs, you can talk in terms of the correlation between the subnetworks, right, the subnetworks that are active, right? And so that's what the overlap matrix is doing. And it turns out that the number of paths that are common for two inputs, right, itself is just basically the product of the number of gates that are on for both inputs. Okay, so the number of gates that are actually on for both inputs in a given layer is again given by the inner product of the gating features, right? For example, in this particular example, for instance, if you take layer one, you have three gates on for input X, and three gates on for input X dash. But the common ones you can find it by taking the inner product of GX of one and GX dash of one, right? Which is basically the binary gating feature for the corresponding to layer one for example X is 10101, and the binary gating feature for the corresponding that is given out by the layer one for example X dash is 01110. So when you take the inner product of these two, you get just the common one. So we can do this, right? So basically, all that we are saying is that the amount of paths that are kind of overlap. simultaneously. And what we can actually show is that the neural path kernel, right, which is the inner product of the neural path features, is basically product of the inner product of the inputs and the gating features, the binary features in each layer, right? So this is a very, very simple kernel, right? So you have a neural network, you know the input, you know the inner product of the input, and then you know which gate is on and which gate is off, right? There is a binary gating feature in each layer, right? And if you take the inner product of the gating features for the two inputs, you have this kernel, right? So yeah, and what we could show is that this kernel has some nice properties, such as in the case of CNNs, if you have, because you have convolutions and weight sharing, this kernel itself has, so I will take this question. I think there is a question here. I will take this soon. So yeah, let me complete this slide. So so here what we have is that, so see the kernel itself, right? So it's in the case of convolutions, it's sort of rotationally invariant, right? And in the case of residual networks, what happens is that and say two skip connections within this network, there are 2^4 subnetwork configurations, right? Based on which skip connection you choose and which skip connection you keep, right? And so what happens is that the kernel itself is just a sum of kernels, and each of this kernel itself is a product kernel. Right, and yeah, so coming to the question, yes, the paths getting left out, right? They are just getting left out automatically, right? So whether does it tell us anything about pruning? It tells us that even in standard training, the network sort of learns to prune out the paths in an input dependent fashion. But yeah, so this work has some implication to pruning, but I mean, that's not the main focus of this talk. That I think that's something that we can, this question is something that we can take at the end of the talk, right? So yeah. So now the question is that, can we understand the gates, right? So the gates are the ones that are actually telling which path is on or off, and that's what is the neural path feature. And can we understand the gates and the weights separately? That's the next question. And in order to do that, what we can do is to have two networks, right? So you have a DNN with ReLU. So what you do is you make two copies of the network. Right, the top network is what is known as the feature network, which is basically the DNN with ReLU itself, right? Which so you give the input of the network, and then you know which gate is on and which gate is off, right? And you take the gating signals, right, which is basically on or off signal, and then you take it and you apply these gates as masks to the bottom network, which contains gated linear units. Okay. So the gated linear units are nothing but so these are just taking these external gating signals from the top network, right? And so they multiply their pre-activations by the and the external gating signal to produce the output. Okay, so the gates in the bottom is replicating whatever is happening in the top network, right? And so the neural path values, basically, which depends on only the weights, is learned in the bottom network, and the top network sort of controls the neural path features, right? So what happens here is that the neural tangent kernel, right, the kernel of the gradients, right, if you take the gradient of the output, it has two components, one component coming from how the gates change, and the other component that comes from how the weights change, right? So in this setting, what we were able to we looked at the setting, and then we asked what happens if you fix the gates, right? So by fixing the gates, what we mean is that for each input, some set of gates are on. So you just have that gates, and then you take that and then copy it and then put it down, and then you train the network at the bottom, right? That's what we mean by fixing the gates, or fixing the neural path features, and just learn the neural path values. Just like asking what happens when you learn the weights of a linear model, where the features are fixed and the weights are not, right? And what we managed to show is that in that case, the neural tangent kernel itself becomes the neural path kernel, right? Which means that when you are fixing the gates and when you are training the weights, what matters, so it's equivalent to a kernel method, which the kernel known as the neural path kernel, because now the neural tangent kernel has become the neural path kernel, right? If you take an infinitely wide DNN, right, and then you fix the gates and you train just the weights, what happens is that that infinitely wide neural network is just basically equal to the neural path kernel, okay? Which means everything depends on the gates, right? Because you can just forget the weights, right? So we have sort of assumed, to get this result, we assume that the neural path features and neural path values are statistically independent. They are initialized around statistically independent of each other, which does not hold for DNNs with ReLUs, because based on the fact that you know, a particular gate is on or off, you can tell, you can the statistics of the incoming weights is kind of, it's correlated, right? The incoming weights and the activity are correlated. Here we are just taking the gates from one network and then but putting it in the other network. But our experiment show that this assumption actually does not cut, right? And there is a lot to be gained in terms of intuition and insights because of this result, right? So the, yeah, so the biggest takeaway is that finally what we show is that, you know, if the neural path kernel itself, right, it's basically what is lying at the heart is just the product of these binary feature vectors, right? And where the role of the depth itself is to take the product, and the effect of the width itself is to provide us the average, right? So at the heart of the deep neural networks with rectified linear units is this kernel, which is just measuring, you know, how many fraction of gates are on per layer. That's how similar two inputs are, right? If similar amount of gates, similar fraction of gates get triggered for two different inputs, then, you know, I mean, if more number of gates, right, are getting triggered, then you consider the inputs to be similar. And if less number of gates are getting turned on simultaneously, you just think that you know that the inputs are dissimilar, right? And you take the product of these very simple kernels, and that seems to be the core of what the neural path kernel constitutes. Okay, so then we can ask this question of what happens, you know, when we fix the neural path features. What happens with random neural path features? Which is basically, if you start with random gates, what happens? Or we can also ask what happens if you pre-train the network, the pre-train the gates, and then you apply them as masks. And you can also ask whether can we learn these two things, the gates and the weights, separately, right? And you can again use this deep gator network setup, where you have again the two networks. The top network is providing the gates, and the bottom network is just learning the weights. And if you want the gates to be fixed, you just don't train the top network. And then if you want the gates to be random, you just randomly initialize and keep it fixed, and then you just train the bottom network. And you can again play with the initialization, where you know, you can initialize both of the networks, you know, statistically independent of each other, or you can start with identical initialization, right? And or if you want to measure how good are the gates, right? You can first pre-train the gates of the top network, which is basically a network with ReLUs, right? And you can then freeze that network and train the bottom network. Or what you can do is that you can just you know, initialize both networks at random, and then you can just sort of train both of the networks together, right? And so what happens when we do this? So when we do this, so this is what we observe. So we characterized the gates experimentally, right, on data sets such as CIFAR-10. So what we chose was a DNN with rectified linear units, where you know, there are four convolutional layers followed by global average pooling, and then just a linear layer and softmax. So this rectified linear unit itself, I mean, this DNN with ReLU itself gave us something close to 80.4% on CIFAR-10. Right. So even though this is not the state of the art accuracy, but for an off-the-shelf model, this is sort of the ballpark number. The number can go as high as 95 if you go to a model like VGG or ResNet. And all the experiments that I am showing here, we were able to replicate similar results on models that give even higher accuracy. So yeah. So this is just a toy model, so that or the vanilla model, so that we are able to understand what. Right, then what you do is that you just in order to understand what's the information that's stored in the gates, right, we pulled these gates out from this train network, and then you apply them as masks, and then you train the bottom network, right, and then that gives us 79.5%, which means almost all the information is there in the gates, right, because the gates are encoded as these neural path features. So basically you are having the features fixed, and then you are learning the weights, and just with our standard understanding of any linear, given the features, you can always train the weights. That seems to be the case, because all the input dependent information is there in the gates, which is encoded as the neural path features. And if you give the neural path features the weights, which is encoded as the neural path value, that can be learned from scratch, right? So we know that all the information is in the gates, right? And so experiment with random gates. So what we did was to say that, okay, what happens if you just do not train the network, you just keep the network, just randomly initialize the network, and then you just use those gates as masks and then train the bottom network. What you observe is that you get 67.5%, right? So that means, so the significant learning, there is significant learning in the gates that happens during training, because the difference between 67.5 and 79.5 is sort of huge, right? And that's just plainly coming from the learning in the gates. So, and we also know that this is the difference between the infinite width and the finite width regime, right? So this is one of the questions that was not understood as to why are infinite width neural networks worse than finite width neural networks. So here we have two finite width neural networks, one with the finite width network with random gates, and the other finite width network with learned gates. And then we observe that the learned gate is actually, the network with the learned gates is performing as good as the the original model, because the difference is 80.4 and 79.5, which is less than 1%. But the difference between the random gates and the learned gates is huge, and the neural tangent kernel is sort of sandwiched between these two finite width networks, right? So what we know is that it's just not that the finite width is playing a role. It is also important that the gates are learned during training. Okay, so we also looked at how this the gates are learned as the training proceeds. So we sort of froze the training of the top network at multiple points, right? So you have random gates, and then you train the network for 10 epochs, and then you copy the gates and train the bottom network, right, from scratch. And then you train the top network for 20 epochs, freeze the gates, and then train the bottom network for another from scratch. And then what we see is that the gates from a trained network, right, as the the performance of the gates themselves monotonically increase as you copy these gates from trained networks, right? The gates of the trained network performs much better, and this is sort of continuous, right? So this this tells us that as you keep training, the gates are also learned continuously as the training proceeds. So this is just showing the dynamics, right? So the intuition here is that finite bits sort of hurts initially because the averaging is poor, right? Because what we had was the kernel itself is measuring the average number of gates that are getting turned on simultaneously for both inputs. So the averaging is poor, which is why the infinite width neural tangent kernel performs better, because it has infinite width and it has better averaging. But then since the gates are correcting themselves based on the data set, the learning in the gates sort of offsets what happens, the offsets the effect due to finite width, the poor averaging due to finite width. And then it's able to learn a kernel that's better than the initial kernel that corresponds to randomized gates, right? And then we can even go beyond dismantling. So what we observe is that the kernel itself has certain nice properties, such as permutation invariance. Like you can actually, when you are using these gates as masks, you can actually permute them, right? Because five gates on in the first layer and two gates on in the second layer gives me 10 paths that are active. If I swap the two gates on in the first network and first layer and five gates on in the second layer also gives me the same 10 paths that are active, right? So all that depends on the activity of the path activity. So you get same number of paths that are active, and the kernel is sort of permutation invariant, and you can even provide a constant input to the network, the bottom network, and the you see the kernel still retains information because it has the information from the gates. So we went ahead and did this. So we even gave a constant random input, and when we copied the masks, as when we applied the gates, we applied the gates in the reverse order, right? We took this four-layer network, and then the fourth layer gates are applied in the first layer, right? And the first layer gates are applied in the fourth layer, right? First layer gates are seen first, the gates are coming from the top network, and when they're getting applied, they're getting applied in the bottom network. And so on the top is the layer by layer output of the top network, and in the bottom is the layer by layer output of the bottom network. It starts from a totally random input, and then its gates are also swapped, and then you can see that the visualization is not really great, which tells us that visual interpretation of the hidden layer outputs is not really the same. It's not really what it is, right? And both of these networks really give the same accuracy. Okay, and so coming to the big questions. So we sort of encoded the gates in what is known as the neural path kernel, and what we could see is that yes, the learning in the gates is what is separating the finite and the infinite with deep neural networks. And we understood that the once you have the gates, right, the weights themselves are kind of expendable. You can always reset and retrain the weights, right? So the major role of the weights is to trigger the gates. But that said, the gates, once you have the gates, you really can retrain the weights. And the role of the depth itself is to provide the product in the product kernel, and the role of the width is to give averaging, and the role of the activation is just gating, and these gates are getting learned, right? And representation and interpretability, what we gave is that we really said that you can represent these networks as paths and not necessarily layers, and you can interpret them as subnetworks, and the actual representation that's being learned is something like a binary representation, which tells us like which path is on and which path is off, right? Which is completely complementary to what we will have in the standard interpretation. So with that, so thanks everyone for patient listening, and also my apologies because I got dropped out for a couple of times.
Thanks Chandrasekhar. So maybe some quick one question from Rahul, because he already posted, why are infinite width neural networks easier to or possible to analyze? Does it have anything to do with the asymptotic properties?
So the infinite width, yes, because all the random variables will converge, right? So you can sort of start using law of large numbers, and you sort of get the averaging, and then these things converge to nice distributions, and then you can sort of look at what's happening. Yeah, so the infinite width is basically the law of large numbers kicks in, right? So yeah.
So one more quick question, like can paths that showing low activity be discarded from the neural network? That is, can this analysis be used to make the deep neural networks sparse?
Yeah, so this has some connection to that kind of work, but not entirely. So what we are saying is that the neural network is actually learning to learning to control the paths that are active and inactive. So if the path is totally inactive for all the examples, right, if it is dead, then we can actually go ahead and discard, right? But this also shows some supporting evidence to what is known as the lottery ticket hypothesis, where people just prune the network from randomized initialization and they are able to get performance, right? But yeah, at that level, it's giving a connection, but it's not giving directly, this work is not directly giving an algorithm to prune the paths themselves. But it is certainly connected to that intuition. Yeah.
So thanks, Chandrasekhar, for a wonderful talk. Nice to see you again.
Yeah.
So we'll stop here. Thank you again.
Thanks.